Wow, it's a beautiful day on the Salish Sea. We're here between the San Juan Islands off of Washington State and the southwest corner of Canada. We're going to be photographing southern resident killer whales. This is something I've always wanted to do, so I'm really psyched about it. I'm your host, Doug Gardner, and your wild photo adventure starts now. Hey, Spencer. How you doing?
Great. Great to see you, Doug. Aaron.
Welcome aboard the Legacy. You ready to go on an adventure today?
I'm psyched about this.
Super stoked.
I've never had the opportunity to go out and shoot orca whales, something I've always wanted to do. You know, and it looks like I got great weather for it, too.
You come to the right place, and we've had a lot of whale activity in the area. Good. And if you're ready to go, let's go see some whales.
So, Doug, we're going to be heading out to the west side of San Juan Island. That's where the whales come in the summertime to feed. And the southern resident orcas feed on salmon. They come in, they hit the side of San Juan Island, and they're going to eat Chinook salmon. So it's Harrow Strait on the west side of San Juan Island. It's one of the best places in the world to see orcas in the wild. So even though we're looking for orcas, we don't want to miss this opportunity to watch some harbor seals here on the rocks. There's a few pups out there.
Very cool. Wow, let's try to get some shots of this. That's my favorite scenario right there, guys. All right, the pup is in the water directly under him. Do y'all see that?
I see the pup there, yeah.
There's two pups.
A whole group of them there, Doug.
Oh yeah.
I see about six or seven swimming. Group of about four of them there, right out in front.
Yeah, this is really cool. That white and black one is looking straight at me. They look so awkward when they're sitting on the rocks. They, it looks like it cannot be comfortable.
Yeah, I know. But they're having a good time up there, just laying in the sun.
Yep. We've got some pups over here in the kelp bed. Yeah, because we got a little bit of rock and roll here and I'm hand-holding, I'm having to shoot 2,500th of a second and I'm shooting a aperture of 5.6 so I can kind of blur the rocks a little bit and yet my subject is nice, tack sharp and pops out from the scene. These should be some nice images. Can't wait to get back and look at them. Oh yeah, very young pup, newly born. Nice shot.
Adorable.
Very adorable. Oh,
them looking at each other.
Light's a little harsh, but still a nice shot.
Doug, I'm using my monopod on these seals to help both stabilize my lens and basically save my muscle power, because when you're hand holding the lens all day long, it can start to wear on you a little bit.
Absolutely. That's nice. Aaron, I'm still locked on these cute guys. Look at
that interaction. Look at this.
Oh my gosh. And one nice thing about this particular scenario is that they're dry. You know, a wet seal has really, really shiny fur, and when you start getting harsh light and wet fur, I mean, that's just an exposure nightmare. Beautiful little rock outcrop here. It's got lichen growing all over it, got some green vegetation out there on the top. A little spot of color here. Very nice. Well, this little rocky island is full of seals.
Doug, I'm using a 70 to 200 lens, and that allows me to pull back and kind of get some shots of the whole island, as well as get zoomed in on the right in on the subjects.
Yeah, more of kind of an environmental portrait, showing where the animal's living.
Yeah. And typically I like to use a little bit of a larger lens on a situation like this, but we're able to get in kind of close without affecting the animal's behavior, and so it's working well.
Spence, you got any reports on whales? Are you seeing anything up ahead of us?
We just got a report of some whales.
Well, let's go. Let's go. This is awesome. Awesome. But let's get some whales, man.
Yeah.
So guys, we're gonna go out and see these whales, and I'm gonna try to get you close enough to get some good shots. But we have some rules in place for good reason, to not disturb the orcas. So we have a 200 yard rule, and we also stay a quarter mile offshore. On the west side of San Juan Island, the orcas use the shoreline to chase their prey, which is king salmon or Chinook salmon, and we just don't want to interfere with their ability to do that. So the southern resident killer whales are an endangered species. They were put on the endangered species list a few years back. Up to a third of the population was taken for the marine parks, and there's some other things that are compounding the issues, and the biggest being lack of salmon, lack of Chinook salmon. Orcas are actually the largest dolphin on Earth. The males can get up to about 8 tons, which is the size of a school bus. So they're pretty easy to spot out there. The males have about a 6-foot dorsal fin on them, and they require about 300 pounds of salmon a day to sustain one of those guys. The females are a little smaller hooked shaped dorsal fin. You're gonna see a lot more of those out here than the males. And they're about 24 feet long, so a little smaller than a school bus. But it's a matriarchal society. It's the oldest female rules the roost. And let me show you something here. This is Granny, and she's the matriarch of the pod that we're gonna go see. Look at that day that she was born. That's an estimated, but it's a conservative estimate. The things we're gonna look for are spy hops. They can see and hear as well as we can. They come up and they'll look around. That's when their head comes out of the water, and they're just doing that to look around and listen what's around them. We're gonna look for breaches. That's where their whole body comes out. And a few theories behind that is it's a, well, the one I buy into, and it's the one that most people do, is it's a form of play. It could also be communication or a way to release parasites like sea lice too. We're gonna look for fluke slaps. That's another way possibly to communicate. They lift their tail and smash the water. They do cartwheels. They rub and roll on each other. Being wild animals, they're unpredictable as far as photography is concerned. They're very difficult to photograph. And people come out here on one trip and they think they're gonna get the photo of a lifetime, and sometimes they do, but you really have to put your time in to get those shots. When the magic happens, it happens all of a sudden, though. You're gonna get breaches, and sometimes you get all the behavior all in one, and then other times you come out here and they're, say, foraging, where they're coming up to breathe and then going down for 15 minutes at a time. All right, guys, we got our first animals out here off our port side, about 500 yards out, and we're just gonna come in closely and parallel them.
Out to the left.
Yep, I'm on them. Wow, look how tall that dorsal fin is.
Oh, yeah.
You just don't realize how big an animal that is until you actually get out here with them.
Yeah, and I believe they get up to 6 feet tall. Yep. Look out over here.
Oh, yeah. I'm not blocking you, Em.
No. They're kind of rolling through the water.
I tell you, you really got to shoot a lot to get a little in this kind of situation. Yeah. We got the boat moving up and down, and then the sheer unpredictability of where the animal's going to surface, that makes it really tough.
Yeah.
But I know back in the Carolinas, we do shoot a lot of a dolphin, and you kind of got to watch. They'll have kind of a trajectory that they stay on, and wow, you'll see them. They'll surface and go under, and the surface and go under, and then you can kind of judge, about this, they're surfacing about every 75 to 100 yards, and that's about the best you can do.
Yeah, you just kind of keep your camera up by your face and get ready for them to pop up. Try and pull that shutter as fast as you can as soon as you see their black fin come out of the water. I also keep my shutter speed real high in situations like this, obviously because of all the movement, the shake, and the animal is moving real fast out of the water as well.
Yeah, I'm bouncing around between 3,200 and 2,500th of a second, and everything's moving, so you gotta try to stop that action in order to get tack sharp images.
Yep.
And this is a perfect situation for autofocus. I mean, everybody knows, because I preach it, to learn how to use manual focus and manual exposure techniques. Mm-hmm. But I'm gonna tell you, I'm autofocusing this because it's impossible to react to seeing the animal quick enough and try to manual focus. By the time you do all that, he's gone. So this is a perfect situation for autofocus.
Yeah.
All right, we got some more coming along behind us here. Got a, looks like a calf right there coming up. Come on, let me get a good shot. So that's mother and calf. You know, I thought we were supposed to be shooting orcas. I mean, harbor seals and kelp beds, but you know what? I'm not gonna ever turn down a beautiful opportunity. This is really cool. I mean, awesome abstract shot here.
Definitely fascinates me. I think this is gorgeous, and I think it's worth stopping along the way.
Just looks like somebody put every little piece of it in a row, and that is really cool. I'm gonna climb up on top of the boat and try to get a little bit different perspective.
Yeah, I'll follow you. One of the mistakes I think that wildlife photographers make is they forget sometimes to capture the environment that the animals are in. So stopping at a kelp bed like this is just, it's essential. It's part of the surrounding environment where the orcas live. You want to be able to capture that.
You find all kinds of other, animals around these kelp beds. I mean, this is its own ecosystem by itself. And you'll find seals, harbor seals, in and around these kelp beds as well. Now I know, we're out here trying to photograph the southern resident orcas, or killer whales, and they, they mostly feast on salmon. But you also have the transient orcas, and they are all mammal eaters, right?
Yep.
All meat eaters. So, if you find seals, you can find meat eaters. All right, let's get back to shooting orcas. No more kelp beds, no more seals.
Okay, deal.
I caught a bald eagle.
Yeah, I set up a bald eagle.
Hey guys, let me show you this. This is Nereocystis or bull kelp. I just cut the blades off of it, and it's the fastest growing algae on Earth. And 12 to 18 inches a day it can grow in the summertime.
Wow.
And kind of interesting, it's has a gas inside of it. It's under pressure, and if you listen here, you'll hear it when I cut into it. You hear that?
Oh, cool. Yeah.
That's pure carbon monoxide on the inside of it. So it's one of the only algaes on Earth plants on Earth that actually harnesses or produces carbon monoxide. And something we do for the children on days that there's no whales, we just have a little bit of fun with them. And we make them little voodoo dolls.
Really cool.
This is actually, it's edible. It's almost 16% protein on this thing.
You're kidding me.
It's quite good. We make pickles out of it, and kelp pickles are delicious. I should have brought some along today.
Can I try some of that?
Would you like to?
Yeah, can you eat it raw?
Yeah, you can actually.
Yeah, I want to try some.
We'll get the skin off of it. It's got a little bit of a kind of a marine flavor is what I call it. When it's like this, but
marine flavors.
Yeah,
that's scary, isn't it?
And fun thing about this kelp doll is if you put it out in the sun, it just shrinks up into a little old man, and the kids get to take it home.
So killer whale or orca? I hear both. I mean, is one correct and one not?
They're both correct. These are technically called southern resident killer whales, orca. Is another word, or if you're a science guy, it's Orcinus orca.
Okay.
Hey guys, I've got a hydrophone here, and I'm gonna put it in the water, and watching them is one thing, but listening to them is just another dimension that we like to show our passengers. So the swim bladders of the Chinook salmon are a unique shape, and they bounce that radar right off of their swim bladders, and then they can pick an individual fish out. And we can often hear that, and it's a series of clicks, and we'll hear it on here if they're doing it. They also have a distinct dialect. For each pod has its own dialect, and then there's a universal dialect. And that's what we're hearing. We're actually hearing them talk to each other there.
That is too cool.
I just wish we knew what they were saying.
Now, is that just picking up what the whales that we are seeing in the immediate area, or is picking up beyond that?
The ones that are coming in loud and clear, I'm sure, are the ones that we're watching and photographing here. But if you hear the faint calls in the distance, those are the ones that are out beyond our visual sight. Mm-hmm. Sound travels a long ways underwater. The water doesn't compress, so sound's able to travel for who knows how far these guys can communicate.
That's pretty cool. Aaron, how long have you lived in Washington?
I've lived here my entire life.
Really?
Yeah.
Born and raised,
wow. Yeah. And the cool thing about Washington State is you can spend your entire lifetime photographing the natural world here and never shoot the same, never completely shoot your subject to the fullest.
Right.
You can always find new things to shoot. So you can just kind of get lost in the wild areas around here.
Yeah, no, I've been to your website. You got some phenomenal imagery.
Thank you.
Really, really good stuff. I knew when we first started planning the other show at Olympic National Park, you were telling me, Doug, man, I got ideas for 100 different shows. And by looking at your site, I believe you're right.
Yeah.
This is pretty cool.
Yeah, this is awesome. Here we go.
Yep.
Beautiful.
So what I'm trying to do with my autofocus is I'm actually trying to take that, I'm using a center point sensor. So I'm using one focal point, and I've got it adjusted to the very center of my frame instead of using the cluster or the 21 or 45 autofocus points. I'm using one point, and as soon as that animal breaches the water, the head comes out, I'm trying to get that sensor on him as quick as possible. And a lot of times, he's way out of my frame. And that's what makes it so difficult. But you got to see it and react instantly to get the shot. The other thing about shooting these type of animals is, because you don't know exactly where they're gonna come up, I'm finding it's a lot easier to shoot a shorter lens. I shoot a lot of stuff with a 500 millimeter lens.
Yeah.
And then when you put it on a camera that's got a crop factor, you're talking about, 600-700 millimeters is the effective range is what you're looking at. Using the shorter lens, I'm shooting real loose. So in all actuality, the raw image that you're gonna see is, the whale's only taking up a very small portion of that frame, and you're gonna have to crop in. That's the benefit to having a digital camera that, it's got high megapixels.
Yep.
So you can crop in and get some good stuff. So.
Yeah, definitely keep your camera on the highest setting. And yeah, that's why I chose a 70-200. 70-200 or a 300 prime lens, perfect for being out in the water.
Usually I use a tripod for almost 99% of everything I do. And and I caught myself saying one time that there's not a situation that you can't use a tripod in. And there's not a situation that you can't use it in, but there are situations that it don't work real well. So, but this situation right here, obviously we're not gonna use a tripod. So you're using a monopod, that's a great way to do it. I'm using a gun stock, and most people don't even know what this is. It's basically just a handle rig that mounts to your shoulder, gives you something to hold on, and allows the lens and camera to be bolted to the top of it. And it gives you a third point of contact. So you got one point of contact is your face against the back of the camera. Second point is your hand under the lens, and a third point is the shoulder butt against your shoulder. So the more points of contact, the more stable you're gonna be. Is that working pretty good for you?
Yeah, I found that this works really well for me. And one thing to note about using a monopod when you're on a boat is that you don't wanna directly put it on the boat floor.
Okay.
Because the motor vibrates. That's gonna get you some vibration in your images. Your image is gonna be real soft.
Yeah.
So what I'll do is I'll pick it up a little bit, or rest it on my foot, or something that will take the vibration out of the situation.
Right. Kind of absorb it a little bit.
And shoot, and then if I wanna rest my arm, then I set it back on the ground.
I got you.
So that my arm doesn't get too tired for shooting for the entire day.
Yeah. You go out, you know, you got to find the whales, and then all of a sudden, once you get on them, I mean, it's happening. And then it's over with for a while, and then you got to wait for something else to happen. So, you know, being on top of things and reacting quick, that's the name of the game. I hear them blowing all around us now. Oh, look, they're breaching.
Oh.
Real nice.
Beautiful.
All right, stay on them because they usually breach twice.
Yep.
Oh, this is nice. The whole group come together, guys. Beautiful breach.
We've been waiting a while for that. I'm on him.
Oh, there he goes. Awesome. Oh, I hope I got that. When you're out here shooting these orcas, you're gonna find that they're, you know, very grossly in range as far as, you know, you're gonna see some quarter mile away, you're gonna see some, you know, up within about 200 yards of you. And, you know, by law, you have to stay 200 yards away from them if you're in the US waters. If you're up in Canada, you know, they have a 100 yard rule. But, you know, if you find yourself needing more power, if they're staying a good ways off from you, I would really advise using a teleconverter, adding a teleconverter to your lens and camera combo versus actually going up to a physically larger lens, because the larger the lens, the harder it is to keep it stable. If you're using a camera that has some sort of image stabilizer or vibration reduction built into the lens, it's actually a gyro built into the lens that helps kind of counteract some of the movement of the lens and the movement of the whatever support is holding your lens, whether it's your body or a monopod or whatever. So definitely use that. And by all means, use the fastest frame rate your camera will shoot. You know, if it'll shoot 8 frames a second, shoot 8 frames a second. If it'll shoot 10 frames a second, max that baby out, you know. Don't be afraid to burn those frames. If you get shots that you don't like, you can always delete them, you know? Mm-hmm. But that's the only way you're gonna capture great behavior shots with these magnificent animals.
Wow.
what
amazing creatures.
That is too cool.
You know, Doug, whenever I'm out here photographing these orca whales, I get just this powerful sense of just, it's really hard to describe. It's almost a human-like presence that these orcas have.
Yeah.
They're such majestic creatures.
When I see amazing animals like this, I feel real insignificant. You know, I feel like a really small part of this world. And I mean, this just, you know, when they come up and you can see the white patches on the side and you see them breach like we did, I mean, it's there's no other word other than awe-inspiring, you know? I'm very fortunate to be a photographer and to be able to get out and enjoy stuff just like this. You know, whether I get come away with a shot or not, you know, it's all about the experience.
Yeah, you know? I feel exactly the same.
And really, really cool. Spencer, man, this was awesome. Thank you.
It's been a pleasure having you along.
Great. Aaron, as always, a pleasure shooting with you, buddy.
It's always a pleasure.
Great. You know, folks, I invite each and every one of you to step outside your comfort zone, come do something different, enjoy these magnificent animals for yourself. More information about this week's show is available online. Remember, it's not just about a photograph. It's the outdoor experience. I'm your host, Doug Gardner, for Wild Photo Adventure. We're going to be shooting resident orca whales. That didn't sound right. Eric, I'm... Aaron.
Is it on? It's blinking, huh? It's on?
It's on.
Okay.
Spencer? Man, this has been awesome. I appreciate it.
Well, I've had a
that boop. Blooper number one. You know, folks, I just cannot remember what I was supposed to say. Aaron, as always, it's a pleasure shooting with you.
It's a pleasure.
What? Pleasure shooting with
Always
you, buddy.
A pleasure.
Awesome. Folks, I enjoy doing this over and over again, obviously.